Each year, with the advent of the Arts Festival, a new visiting artist comes to the campus of Ball State College to teach, to lecture, and to paint. Many fine professional artists have participated in this program in the past, people such as Ben Zion, Aaron Borod, and Margot Hoff. The exchange of ideas and problems between the professional artist and the college community has proven to be a vital educational experience. In the summer of 1957, Mr. Hugh Wiley, a New York artist, was selected to contribute to the program largely for his pioneering activities in a unique method of expression. Here in the Arts Building, which houses the permanent collection of paintings by Titian, Holbein, Bellini, Goya, and others, a one-man show of Mr. Wiley's work is open to our inspection. We are entering the portion of the College Art Gallery where the exhibit is located. This is Gallery A, where the collection begins. And this is the artist, Hugh Wiley. In this exhibit, we will see a few of his early works in oils, which preceded his most recent interest in and experimentation with a combination of white cement, latex emulsion, and foreign materials such as mosaics, rocks, marble chips, and marble dust. In the process of working with these materials, Mr. Wiley has developed many interesting variations in the application of the material itself, building up varying depths and using a variety of background panels such as masonite, metal lathing, and hardware cloth. In addition to the few oils, Mr. Wiley's work mainly consisted of cement and foreign materials media. Further interest was created through size and shape variations in the finished panels. The panels ranged in size from small models to panels 10 feet high. One of the items exhibited is a diminutive model of a monument for soldiers lost in the war. Another is a model for a large wall. This variety of size, material, shape, and color made the Wiley Show an exciting visual experience. As we begin to look more closely at Mr. Wiley's work, we are impressed with the rich surface treatment and glowing color, the sparkling contrast of the glossy and hard with the soft and rough. Wiley manages to bridge the gap between the sculptor and the painter, a daring and unique method of expression even in the world of contemporary art. This combination of painting and sculpture contains a vibrant transition, in effect bringing the chisel and easel together in the same composition. This is Mr. Wiley's model for the soldier's monument. If we can adequately, in the mind's eye, convert a small size to a large size, this memorial in reality may be seen 20 or 30 feet high. We must project the model into its full size to realize the emotional impact of the memorial. Then we get the total effect. In this design, Mr. Wiley represents a great departure from the sentimental narrative approach with which most artists in the past have conceived the soldier's monument. It brings to our minds the deep, depressing, and senseless facets of the war and of the aftermath of personal loss and futility that both the civilian and returning soldier feel. We now turn to the other extreme of Mr. Wiley's work, the tall panels, some 10 feet in height. These particular panels were designed to be installed in a Jewish sanctuary. Mr. Wiley wanted the panels placed over the entrance to the sanctuary so that a person would enter through them. Once the observer was in the room, he would feel physically as well as emotionally related to the room and the panels. The color is limited, but nevertheless gives the feeling of richness. The surface is highly embellished through various methods of materials manipulation heightened by the embedded bits of foreign materials. From these panels, one moves to other examples of Mr. Wiley's work which are more average in size. This particular group presents as rich a texture as anyone could manage in such a small area. For some inexplainable reason, we sense here a Victorian Baroque quality in the lushness of this surface. In fact, our childhood memories of grandmother's jet and coral Victorian jewelry somehow correlate with the total effect of these orange and black chips embedded in colors of soft brown, dull black, and lavender. The impression is startling, and we are almost overpowered by this concentration of innumerable materials, including cement, rocks, mosaics, and nails. While painted in New York, the inspiration for this work came from observations Mr. Wiley made during his study in Mexico. He felt deep depression in the gray, austere, poverty-ridden lives of these people. There is an earthy, foreboding gloom emanating from this panel, achieved by the muted, stifling colors, heavy-handed textures, and the stark, unrelenting vertical divisions. It seemed to Mr. Wiley that the Mexican villagers had but one hope in their total existence, their religion. Wherever you move in front of this serape-like panel, you are followed by the eye symbol, which might well be a representation of the Mexican concept of the closeness, ever-judging, ever-presence of God. This is an interesting experiment in texture. The values of red have been built up on a wire mesh screen. The picture was not pre-planned, but took shape as the work progressed. Inspired by a study of Oriental religions, this mosaic has strong overtones of a variety of life situations. The white portions of this, The Desert Storm, were inspired by a torn poster in a New York subway. Mr. Wiley's academic impressions are strongly reflected in this painting, which was done in 1950 after 7 years of study in an art academy. Shortly after this painting was completed, Wiley started his popular mosaic experimentation. One of the more exciting and moving compositions is Storm at Sea, whose turbulence and fury dynamically suggest the movement and uncontrollable qualities of the sea. There is great activity in this canvas, with the cloudy, smoky atmosphere in some portions of it, suggesting the impending qualities of storm clouds. Through an examination of the composition, we are conscious of the heat in some areas, which contrasts strongly with the overall coolness. The warm areas consist of embedded orange mosaics. The major color of the composition is in the cold, uncompromising blues of the storm. In examining the painting closer, we find that when looking at the cool areas, we are reminded of a rocky coastline. These areas have black mosaic, gravel, and sand worked into the cement medium. Here we are more conscious of the effects which can be achieved by varying the background base. Some of the surface variations are the result of the use of different textured bases, such as metal lath, hardware cloth, and masonite. Another deviation found in this panel is that the artist has used a stick or sharp-pointed instrument of some kind to create linear variations on the surface. Many of these linear embellishments are found worked right into the impasto of cement. The whole panel gives the feeling of activity of form, line, and color. The swirling of the wind and the movements of the waves have all been created by a putty knife and other tools which have been used to move the cement into interesting patterns. In past years, the college has always purchased the painting by the visiting artist. In Hugh Wiley's case, it seemed natural to commission him to do a wall panel. After considering several locations, Wiley, with the head of the art department and the librarian, felt that an entrance foyer of the library would be ideal. With this decision made, work on the panel could begin. The artist's palette often reveals more of the artist than some of the other paraphernalia he uses. The palette, with its select variety of colors and color grouping, forecasts some of the temperament and technique to be found in the forthcoming panel. Work has begun with the laying in of the large foundation area, such as this pink one. Here the structure of the painting takes form and the important judgments begin. How large a shape? What size the next one in comparison? What form should the shape take? How does the color modify or enhance the form? What will be the effect of this combination of shape, size, color, and surface? Wiley's painting medium here is powdered pigment and cement. It is a loose, wet, and adhesive mixture which will allow a great deal of surface treatment. In large areas such as this, the simplest of tools are used, a spoon, a stick, or a spatula. A new color is added, closely related to the dominating pink, but this color will not stand alone. Like many of the colors and shapes now on the panel, this one will be the receptacle for the addition of foreign material. Wiley begins to drop bits of light blue tesserae into the soft cement and watches the color relationship take form bit by bit. Inherent in every act in the making of this painting is the factor of constant criticism, constant judgment. Does he like this interaction of repeated blue form on the ground of red earth color? How far should he carry it? How closely should the tesserae be placed, scatter them or cluster them? He continues carefully, embedding the bits more deeply. The painting has a new texture, a new element for the eye and mind to explore. Mr. Wiley prepares to use bits of broken pottery made for him by a friend. These unglazed bisque-fired clay chips provide a subtle area of close colors rich in textural qualities. Here are several elements working together: color, texture, shape, and direction. The main support for this panel is masonite, but some areas are made up of metal lathing. This change of foundation materials is important to Mr. Wiley because their individual characteristics will determine what and how he will build on them. A continuous support such as masonite alone could not supply this variety. Thus, in actuality, the painting begins with the choice and nature of the supporting material. In the finished painting, every visual statement will speak of the work beneath it. With the colored cement being pushed through from the back, a strong pattern results. This pattern may be kept or destroyed as the work progresses. Locking the wire screen in the cement this way, Mr. Wiley assures himself of a solid, almost indestructible support. To prepare the masonite to receive cement, the artist brushes on liquid latex, working it in thoroughly to make sure the cement will bind with the panel. These precautions are very necessary when working with heavy materials of many kinds. Lack of attention to this factor would result in the cement cracking off under any stress. It is immediately apparent that Mr. Wiley has given a great deal of thought regarding the permanency of his work, thus avoiding the criticism of poor craftsmanship, weak construction. The brown cement in a near liquid state is spread on the still wet latex, and since both are water soluble, a strong bond will ensue. It is the accumulation of slight modifications that give Mr. Wiley's work its characteristic sensitivity. This change to a lighter brown is but one of many of these minor but important alterations. Here, the black tesserae are rather informally dropped into the wet cement in order to give a less static arrangement. While much of this type of painting appears to be haphazard, it is apparent that should these chips fall into a pattern something less than desirable, the whole area would be reworked until the right effect is achieved. In the final analysis, the work is the result of intuition and emotion guided by intellect. This is cement treated with brown powdered pigment and fine gravel. It is interesting to recall at this point the fact that Wiley spent many years studying in art academies. His work prior to 1950 was academic in the modern tradition. That is to say, he used conventional painting materials and employed subject matter, abstracted but nonetheless recognizable. A new and different area is now in the making. Thus far, the artist has used masonite, metal lath, powdered pigment, cement, latex emulsion, tesserae, and bisque-fired clay. The area seen here is being prepared to receive small pieces of brass brazing rod. The upended brazing rod represents the strongest statement in the third dimension yet seen in the painting. But the artist knows he must be careful. Too much texture and dimension would bring chaos. With these close-up views of the artist at work, we feel an intimate association with his extreme concentration. One can vicariously feel the power of the activity. His face reflects the continuing process of constant evaluation that must accompany his way of working. Oftentimes, this evaluation and decision-making is subconscious to the point where the artist is sometimes hard-pressed to verbally explain a given act. Here is the object of Mr. Wiley's attention. We may, if we wish, take the viewer's privilege of associating this area with recollections of past experiences. We might see a powerful geographic terrain before us, and as our eyes move in and out, take pleasure in interpreting a growth of stark vegetation. A peat bog, and a field of freshly turned earth. Mr. Wiley has returned to the large pink area and wipes on a layer of a different value. This time his tool is a wide putty knife and he strokes the cement carefully for a soft, smooth finish. He is at the midpoint of the execution of the painting with many differing areas already laid in. With every new innovation, such as the area now under process, he must be prepared to make it fit into the total of the composition, somehow giving it a meaningful place and reason for existence. If the desired balance is not achieved, it may necessitate the modification of an already existing area, or perhaps require the removal of that which was just applied. We see much of this abstract interaction while watching Mr. Wiley proceed. With a change in tool size, the artist makes minor adjustments with the same color. The painting now has enough structure and body to permit an evaluation of it as a whole. The artist works slowly. It is time to reflect and ponder. Scanning a long band of the painting, we are impressed by the vibrancy created by texture and color relationships, the side-by-side visual conversation that each area makes with the next. Now, for the first time, the size and scope of the work can be seen, and we are impressed by its power. With a mixture of powdered pigment and latex emulsion, Mr. Wiley makes several adjustments, some minor, some drastic. A color goes down and it doesn't work. Another color is tried. Areas are expanded, areas eliminated. Conflict or harmony of area to area, sometimes conflict found desirable, more often not. The work progresses in this vein. Since Wiley has no literal subject matter in mind, what then could we hope to gain from viewing this panel? Watching him as we are now, we already know many of the answers. We've seen, and still see, Wiley compound individual colors, struggle to find color combinations and relationships which will delight and intrigue the eye. We watched him lay down shapes, enlarge them, destroy them, adjust them, in his effort to bring perceptible order to their totality. We've witnessed the construction of vigorous multitudinous textures, surfaces so rich in tactile appeal we feel compelled to touch them. We see the power of Wiley's personality communicated in the form of this painting. We vicariously work with him in this communication of feelings, intellect, recollections, and discoveries. We've shared the still moments of self-doubt, re-evaluation, recapitulation, and finally, the individual victories which will add up to the total of beauty. This panel eloquently attests to the greatness of the human mind, the gifts of imagination, intelligence, and creativity. A critical analysis has been made, and a major change is about to take place. The artist has decided a certain large area is incompatible with the rest of the work and begins removing it. With hammer and chisel, he breaks the material away right down to the supporting masonite. Mr. Wiley felt the situation too severe to be corrected by overpainting, so the only choice was the complete removal of all the material in the area. His immediate problem is to destroy the heavy black area which he felt overpowered the adjacent sections. His next step would be to create a compatible bridge between the rather subtle colors of the bisque-fired clay and the light blue tesserae. This is the rubble of the cleaned-out area, the evidence of dissatisfaction, testimony to Hugh Wiley's artistic convictions. Here is another area demanding attention, but this one can be built upon. It has enough merit to retain its basic existence. From this point on, the personality of the painting undergoes minor alterations. Brighten it here, tone it down in another spot. Right to the end, action and counteraction, experimentation and analysis, the signature of Hugh Wiley, the man and his art. We have shared closely with Mr. Wiley some of the problems and solutions which go into the making of a painting. To Wiley's students, the involvement was direct and intense. His pupils painted with him, received his criticism and stimulation, and could watch him day by day in his own personal artistic expressions. The summer painting classes and the whole festival gained vigor and richness by the presence and activity of the artist, Hugh Wiley.